I was going to ask you, their Nisei, right?
Yes.
Do they talk to you now about it? I mean, would it? Okay, I'm going to say ask you another question. How do they feel about here their son was an activist in college, and now look what you're doing? Oh, I'd love to know what they think about that.
Well, they both passed away a while ago,
unfortunately. Oh, they did.
But I think that they didn't really understand what I was doing. However, over time, because I started doing things in the Japanese-American community, I ran a senior community center, I think it became something that they felt some pride in. Even though they still didn't exactly understand what I wasn't become a doctor or a lawyer that they probably thought would be better.
yeah.
I ended up marrying an engineer, so that made them feel better. But I think they started to see why this was important. And I think they felt that I was trying to uncover a history that could help them and other people. And the one story I tell is after, you know, my father had passed away a long time ago, and I went to a funeral of a coworker of his. He worked in Lockheed, and he was with engineers. Probably they were more conservative, generally speaking. But one of them, when he met me, he said, "Oh, you're the one. You're the one who was always pushing these letters about Japanese-American redress." And I didn't know what he was exactly talking about. He goes, "Well, I'm telling you, because your dad kept bringing them to me and asking me to sign them." And so after he started doing this, I just said, his nickname was Doug. He said, "Okay, Doug, just bring it here. I'll sign it. Whatever you want, I'll just sign it." Because they trusted him so much. But I didn't realize my dad was doing this. Because now and then he'd call me and go, "Okay, Tom, where is this redress thing going?" Because it was going through Congress at the time. Are we supposed to write this letter or that? But, "Okay, Dad, I'll send it to you." And I thought he was just kind of humoring me. But I didn't realize he was going around harassing people and getting them to do this, because he actually understood what I was trying to do and he agreed with it. So I think even though they were really worried about their son, who wasn't going to be a doctor or whatever he was supposed to be, they realized this was an important thing to do. And so I think in that way they were very supportive.
And was your mother very active with the JACL, Japanese American Citizen League?
No, not really. She, I think she wanted to avoid the Japanese American community. After the Japanese American internment, she thought it was kind of a very parochial and kind of a narrow country village, so to speak. A lot of ethnic communities can be like that, especially a long time ago.
Yeah.
So she wasn't really that involved, and it wasn't until much later that she started doing more things in the community. So unfortunately, they never really got to talk to me or I to them about more what I do now, because what I do now is look at the history of a lot of different kinds of people. I mean, I use Japanese Americans because that's what I'm very familiar with, and it's kind of what sent me on this path. But I'm interested in all these different histories, and there are just so many different stories out there that people are still finding, because people will say about history, it's boring, it's all done. Why do you think they call it history? But actually, there's always new stories to be found, and it's just amazing what you find out about things.
Can you cite an example of something very dramatic that you have found out about?
Well, not dramatic, other than that there's always these odd connections between different people that you find. Let's see, the California History Center itself is a historic building, but there are different people who have owned it over time. And some of these families had connections to all these other issues. And you wouldn't think that. You think it's just an old building, whatever, it's not that interesting. But the original Baldwin family that built it, it turns out that Baldwin, the husband, his sister married into the English aristocracy. And his sister's daughter, I can't remember the names, or Mr. Baldwin's niece, had this pretty scandalous history in England, and to this day it's pretty famous. We just discovered this, we didn't know this. Other owners after the Baldwins had all sorts of connections and different things that we're just finding out. There was one family that had a connection to development of child care programs, and this was during the 1920s, I believe. So there's all this local history that connects to bigger, broader social issues, whether it's going all the way to Europe or whether it's actually the progressive movement in California. So that might not sound super fascinating to anybody, but That's just an example of just one little thing, taking this building and finding all of these interesting connections that you just never imagined existed.
And we are all connected in some way, mm-hmm. don't you think?
I mean, oh, definitely.
I mean, it's a very broad statement, but it's so, it's like being a historic detective.
Mm-hmm. It
is. And you find out. We only have a couple of minutes left, Tom. What do you envision for the California History Center, say, in the next 10 years? What's going to happen?
Well, it's always a struggle to survive in this climate, given how bad the budget is. My hope is to be able to continue programs like we've started, like the Silicon Valley Documentation Project, to encourage people, especially young people, to go out there and, like you're saying, be these detectives mm-hmm. and to find these stories and capture them, because we have the opportunity to do that. Because a lot of older people will say, man, I wish we had done this before, because now all the people are gone. You can't find anybody. So I don't want that to happen. I want young people to be able to find their history.
Yeah. Well, Tom, has the time gone quickly?
Yes, very quickly.
And you are a wonderful speaker.
Thank you.
I am so happy to have been able to interview you. Very honored. And I wish you only the most fabulous success. And get some really hot dirt on some of these local history people, right? You'll do that next time?
There are certain things I don't want to bring up until maybe, 100 years from now, maybe.
Oh, maybe 100 years. And thank you so much. I also want to thank our crew. We have a very outstanding crew. And talk about young. They are young, but they're very talented. And, of course, I want to thank our audience for watching. And we can't wait to see you next time. Bye-bye.